Good morning. Welcome. It's time to share any announcements we might have.
Well, we lucked out and got a wonderful day for the picnic today. It should be warm and sunny, but low humidity. Come find a spot in the shade. Join us for hot dogs on the grill. And my son-in-law is doing ribs as well. And bring a dish to share, a chair if you have it. We do have parking up by the house for any mobility issues. But we can't fit 20 cars up there. So carpool if you can. If you need directions, see me after the service.
And just a message from hospitality, which is going to sound very inhospitable. In relation to the aforementioned picnic, go big or go home. There's no fellowship. There's no food in there. Okay? Just saying.
If there are no other announcements, feel yourself centered as Michael brings us into the prelude. Reasons why I like coming here. This is just wonderful. Please join me in the prayer of the day, which is printed in your bulletin and on the monitor. God, I am here. My earth, God, commit. Just in the community, to be held in fabric, but does not mean that I always need to be active. Just as he is delivered, when they sleep in their parents' arms, I am just as beloved when I rest or play as when I work. Help me to remember that, I pray. Amen.
Dear God, we give you praise and thanks.
In a time where we can be and exist, we give you thanks and praise. For we know that prayer is a time to exist with you. And we give thanks for this time to be in sanctuary with you. And so we lift up the prayer that your Son taught us together, saying, Our Father and Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know, it's very funny because Jesus was very good at talking to people who were not technically worth anything in the Bible, right? He was always inviting people who were not worth anything. Widows, children, Samaritans, people who didn't have any kids, people who didn't have any land. And so I think it's just very affirming to think about that. And in this time, I think kids can think about, right, how I don't know about you, but when I was a kid, I always thought that people always spoke down to me or spoke at me instead of speaking with me, right? And it was really hard. And my husband says, I often speak to everyone like I'm like their children. And I said, well, good, at least I speak to everyone the same, right? And so I think it's interesting to think about how we speak to people and how Jesus speaks to people. And I often wonder if that's why people felt like they were spoken down to, because he spoke to everyone the same. And they'd be like, you speak to me like you speak to women and children. And Jesus is like, that's right, I do. Right? And I think about that when we think about how we speak to children and what that means. So it's something to think about when we go forward. Amen.
Scripture today is taken from the Psalms and from Isaiah. Psalm 62, verse 1 is, Truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Isaiah 14, On the day the Lord gives you relief from your suffering and turmoil and from the harsh labor forced on you, you will take up this taunt against the king of Babylon. This ends the reading. Thank you.
I don't know if you've noticed this yet, but I do not have the gift of sitting by the well. You know how Jesus meets the Samaritan woman? He's sitting at the well, doing nothing. Do you have the gift of sitting at the well? Some of us have the gift of sitting at the well. There are some people who have the gift of doing nothing. I do not have the gift of doing nothing. This is actually why I skipped some portion of the services, right? Because I'm thinking three steps ahead about what needs to happen next. And so then I'm three steps ahead in the service, right? And I'm like, this is what needs to happen next. And one of my mentors said, you're a really good pastor, but you need to cultivate sitting at the well so that people can approach you. And I had to take a deep breath and be like, not a bad thing, right? Because if you think I walk around now, you should have seen me when I started ministry. I never sat, ever. I ran to every single thing I did. I was like, gotta get the next thing done, gotta get the next thing done, gotta get the next thing done. I thought that ministry and serving God meant I always had to be in motion. And I almost did everything at a run, right? I was like, gotta go over here, gotta go do that. And I was the children's minister, so it kind of made sense, right? I mean, I was running to serve the children. I was like, okay, I gotta go run over here, and then I gotta run over here, and then I gotta run up the steps, and then I gotta run down the steps, and I gotta get the art supplies, and I gotta check the music, and I've gotta dance, and I've gotta do this, and I gotta check that, and I gotta go there. I was always running. And it never occurred to me that I could serve God by sitting at the well. And that I could serve God by doing nothing. I was like, serving means doing things, right? I mean, that's what serving means. And Jesus served God by doing nothing? What? And my mentor said, you have got to cultivate sitting at the well so that people can approach you. Because people can't approach you if you look busy all the time, right? It's hard for people to approach you if you always look like you're doing something. Like it's not, you know, you look too busy. I was like, oh, right? And so it kind of changed my whole idea of what ministry meant and what serving God meant. And it wasn't until many years later that I realized that I don't have to do anything to be worth to God. That just being myself is enough to be worthy to God. I was always striving, 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 striving. And I think part of that is because I don't know who I am or where I am. but I am part of a completely not neurotypical family. No one in my family is in any way neurotypical. And so I'm really good at acting neurotypical, but I am not neurotypical. And we don't know what it is about me particularly, because I can mask really well, but I got something, right? I got something. And so in a neurotypical environment, note, that's usually not church, right? That's somewhere else, because church is where I can kind of be myself. I act very neurotypical, right? And way. But I learned very quickly that if you don't act a certain way, you're not worth it, right? You're not worthy. You have to act a certain way and do certain things and be certain ways in order to be worth stuff. And I was not a typical little girl. I didn't like dolls. I didn't like playing, I didn't like playing dress up. I've never worn makeup, right? And I didn't know how to get along and deal with stuff. All my friends were either older than me or younger than me. I've never basically had friends my own age my entire existence. I had friends, but not my own age. And I learned very quickly, you have to be a certain way in order to be worthwhile, right? You are worthy. And I didn't know what was different about me, but let me tell you, every kid my age could tell I was different. Right? There was no diagnostic test for what made me different, but every kid could tell, right? Every kid was like, there's something a little off about this one, right? And so they could kind of tell, we're not so sure about this one. And now I'm like a fully successful adult, and I hang out with everyone who's a little different, and everything's fine. Right? And it's not a big deal. And I'm the person everyone turns to for the not neurotypical kids, right? They're like, hey, I have this kid and they're not neurotypical. What would you do? Right? And all the pastors with not neurotypical kids in their church are like, how can we be more welcoming to them? Like, oh, I have the pastor you should call. Call up Katie. She's the one. She knows how to make it more accessible because she's got three kids and they all got different needs and she's kind of different herself and the whole thing. So it's like all kind of worked out, but the worth thing is still kind of weird, right? And the Bible passages for today are really funny because in God alone, I truly find my rest and my worth, right? That's the Psalm. And in God alone, I will never be shaken because I know who I am when I spend time with God. Right? When I sit with God, I'm like, oh, I'm me. That's okay. God made me who I am. And I am the best version of me possible. And I don't know what that means, and I don't know how that works, but God made me me for some reason. And my birth was not a mistake. What an earth-shaking statement. Can you say that to yourself and really believe it? My birth was not a mistake. I was not a mistake. I was not made this way by mistake. You know, someone whose brain works a little bit differently, and I always say grace is not one of God's gifts to me. I am one of the clumsiest people I know. I just hide it really well at this point in my life. My birth is not a mistake. All the ways I kind of weirdly understand the world, all the ways I kind of deal with things, I was meant to be this way. I meant to exist in this very way, in this very world, in this very existence. I don't know, there's a lot of arguments about people's worth going on. Have you looked at the world today? Have you seen the Olympics? Have you seen voter registration? Have you heard about single cat ladies and what they're worth at this moment? right? Have you heard arguments about the drag show and like, was it Bacchus or was it the Lord's Supper and was it worth it and was it art and what's going on and what is our worth? And then the reading says, you know, when you rest in God, it makes a mockery of tyranny. I love that idea. When you're allowed to rest, it makes a mockery of all tyranny, because you know what your worth is. And when, you know, dictators say, oh, well, you're not worth anything, you're like, you think? I'm resting in my worth in God. You can't define me. I've already defined my identity. It's my identity in God, in who I am. And I've woven my trust, not in trust funds, but in community. And when you build trust in community, it's a completely different trust. I love that we have the same word, trust, in communities. Building trust in communities versus building trust in trust funds. And they mean totally different things. Have you ever heard of the system in immigrant communities when they build an unbanked system of money? It's fascinating. So they all put like $300 or $500 or $1,000 in a pot with each other. And then when someone needs it, they decide as a community to give it to that person. And that's how they start a business or buy a house or help someone who has just had a baby. And it's a completely unbanked service. And they do it that way. And it doesn't have interest. They just all have this pot of money and then they give it to the person in need. And that is a trust fund that is unbanked, that is how these communities all take care of one another. And I love it because it's the complete opposite of how we do banking, right? We do banking because we look at how many assets you have and are you a good, reliable person and do you have enough needs? And this community is like, now we know each other. We love each other. Oh, you have a great need right now. Okay, we're gonna invest in you. And then, because we've invested in you, we're all going to go buy from your nail shop because we all invested in it and we want it to survive, right? We all invested in it and we all gave you the money and we want it to survive. And then when that person can, they put all that money back so that the next person can get that fund it is. Now that's a trust fund, right? And the whole community supports it and that's how they run it. And it's completely untraceable, right? And that's how communities back each other. And that is how people are worth investment and community and building each other up. And when I worked at the Korean church, that's how they were like supporting each other in the network, right? They were like, oh yeah, this is what we do and this is how we're taking care of each other and how we're doing it. And it cracks me up when people are like, talk about the immigrants who are coming over who are like the web of immigrants who have this web who are they're bringing over, and I'm like, that's exactly who you want, because they have these untraceable networks of support that we don't even see because we're used to like these banks and these other things. And they come over and they give them clothes and they give them housing and they give them these trust funds and they really help them out in ways that white Americans are like, we don't even know how they're surviving. Yeah, we don't. Because we look at their worth in dollars and cents and votes. And here they are, building their community networks. And they have people who are saying, you're worthy because you are. And because you're part of our community. And we're not looking at the normal things of community. And maybe we don't know what you've done yet because you just came over and we don't really know you yet, but that's okay. We think you're worth investing in. And sometimes they're even like, you just rest. You just got here. You rest for a minute. And they try to work and they're like, please just rest for a minute because you just got here and we're going to take care of all your needs so you can get on your feet and then we're going to help you get going. And then it's a pushful because usually those people really want to work. So, you know, that doesn't really work out, but that's okay. The point is your worth is not about how much you produce, right? It's about that you build a community and you build a relationship and you have people who invest in you, and your strongest worth is your community and how people are supporting you. I don't know anyone who got to where they are today because the community isn't backing them up. And they did all these interviews of people who are like really successful and they're like, I did it myself. And then as soon as you start digging deeper, okay, well, how'd you get your first job? Oh, well, my friend helped me get my first job. And then it helped me get here and helped me get there. And it turned out it was all community roots that helped them get to where they are today, which is fabulous. That's how it should be. But we have this dominant narrative that you have to be all by yourself. But our worth is worthy because we're beautiful human beings made in the image of God. And nothing can shake that. And when we stop working, for whatever reasons, we're still beautiful human beings. And if we don't have children, we're still beautiful human beings. And if we're sick, we're still beautiful human beings. That one's a hard one, right? Because we would like our bodies to work exactly like we want them to be. We want them to be perfect human bodies. But the reality is our worth is not dependent on, you know, where we come from, what we look like, if we can vote, what our nationality is, if we have a perfect past and have done everything perfectly, because I don't know about you, but I am not perfect and I never will be. The minute we start putting people's worth on all these tiers and shelves, we're not understanding each other to be beloved children of God. What does church look like when we offer ourselves to be a true sanctuary and a true place of rest? What does it mean to say our God is the one who says you are worthy? You are the beloved one. You are the one that God loves no matter what. What does it mean that we are not worth our productivity? What does it mean that we have a Jesus who did ministry by sitting by a well? How does that change what does it mean to be a church? What does that change about our ministry and what our ministry should look like? I think we're very stuck in the church has to do, right? And I love doing things, right? I've already said I am a productive person. I want to be doing all the time. What do we have to offer as a church if we're a church that doesn't have to do things all the time? What does it mean to just be the church? I don't know. I don't think we've done it in a really long time. But I'd love to find out. I think it'd be a beautiful place to be a place where we can say, you are worthy. You are beloved. Just the way you are. Friends, this is the good news of the gospel. Thanks be to God. Pray for all those other places that are war-torn and in danger. We think of Gaza, we think of Syria, we think of Sudan and Ukraine. Just so many places, God. We want peace everlasting. We pray for Israel and Palestine, and that we can do a better job of staying out of places that we need to stay out of and speaking for peace when we need to speak for peace. And God, I give thanks that you are always listening when we pray, no matter what part of the service we've raised those prayers in. And we pray that we know our worth, that we can sit with you, that we can understand that we were born on purpose, that you made us to be your beautiful, beloved humans, and that you love us exactly as we are. May we treat one another as beloved and worthy human beings. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So we're going to respond before our hymn by breathing in and thinking, I am born, and breathing out and thinking, I deserve rest. Or if you don't like that one, you could do your own breath prayer. We've done enough of these now, right, that you could do your own and think of your own. Breathe in and think of one phrase, and breathe out and think of another for 3 or 4 breaths. Let us pray. Amen. Our next hymn is a familiar tune, so if you think you don't know it, you do.
Restore our common life, our own.
into the world, celebrating the worth of all humanity, and knowing that we are blessed. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen.